Mo system, Mo is an acronym for Mobot, and the Mobot was a underwater vehicle. It was before the name ROV, remote control vehicle, which is now the acronym for the eyes and the hands of people working on the seafloor. So at that time, there were no ROVs that you could use for doing robotic work on the seafloor. And so Shell, the heart of this MO system was the Mobot, which was a basically a swimming socket wrench in a lot of sense. It had various fixtures and tools that could articulate and screw and grasp, and it had television and acoustics, so you could sense what you were doing. So this tool would go down and work on this underwater wellhead. And the philosophy behind this MO system was to have a very simple land-type wellhead, but a rather complex and sophisticated support tool being the Mobot. And so it was kind of a, it was extremely innovative at that time, because as far as I know, you know, it was the first use of automatic robot, if you want to call it, we call it Mobot, to do underwater work on a subsea wellhead.
Were you working on the design of the Mobot or its use? Or?
I was, the Mobot was actually designed by a huge tool. They were under contract to Shell. And this fellow named Glenn Johnson and Bill Bates, Bill Bates was the manager of the Marine Division at that time, they had this vision of using this Mobot in this fashion. So they started the idea. And then the Mobot went through various evolutionary phases by initially Hughes Tool, and then it was later modified by Ventura Tool Company and other contractors to Shell to take, you know, different shapes over the years. But the original Mobot was developed by Hughes Tool. There was also a sister tool. It was called Unimo, which was another underwater support tool that had five articulated arms. It looked very spacey. And it was developed, but it really never did mature into an oil field tool, whereas the Mobot did. It was used, you know, quite effectively in our drilling program up off of Oregon and Washington and Northern California. So that was my start in design and application of subsea hardware and tools to drill and produce oil and gas.
Did you work in the Cook Inlet?
I didn't work in the Cook Inlet, but I worked on some of the equipment that went to the Cook Inlet. There was another team that took this equipment to the Cook Inlet, but I worked on the same equipment that went up there. They had some unique conditions up there, and it was mainly the currents. It was they drilled initially with Cuss 1, which was one of the real early drilling vessels, a ship-shaped drilling vessel, and they moored it in the Cook Inlet. It was relatively shallow water there. I think it was 120 to 30 feet of water. But the unique problem were the currents, and there were a lot of problems related to vortex-induced vibrations, or the vibrations of the equipment as you lower it through the water column in high currents. And we had lots of failures, or several failures of equipment, you know, because of this phenomena. And there had to be design solutions developed to overcome it.
Could you work it out? That ice flow seems like the, or even the flow without the ice.
Yeah, well, you would only drill from floating rigs during the ice-free seasons. And so you had a relatively narrow window to drill there, and then you'd have to move the floating rig out during the winter time. After they made the discovery, then they designed and installed the bottom founded structures, the middle ground shoal structures that then they used to do the remaining drilling and development of that field. And then about 1964, it was decided that Shell couldn't continue with the luxury to have two teams, each working on their own separate system. So they decided to mesh them, pull them together. So there was a new group formed on the West Coast called the Marine Technology Group, and it was headed up by Ron Gear. And many of the members of the Mo team and the RUDAC team joined this new team called MTG, Marine Technology Group. And the objective of that team was to develop floating drilling and subsea technology that could be used in up to 1,000 feet of water, which was maybe 500-600 feet deeper than what was perceived to be the objective of the Mo system and the RUDAC system. So this team went to work and designed a new system. And it was a system that had some of the elements of both the Mo system and the RUDAC system, but I would say it had probably more elements of the RUDAC system in that it was a guideline system. It had a lot of the same wellhead, casing hanger, blowout preventer concepts that were used in the RUDAC system. Some of the same marine riser systems that were used in the Mo system were used in this MTG system. And so that effort went on for maybe 4 years, 3 or 4 years. And out of that effort came a system that we could drill wells in deep water, and we did drill wells up off of Oregon, Washington, Northern California. That program was still underway. And in fact, while the drilling campaign up in the Pacific Northwest was underway, we changed out the Mo system with the MTG system. And some of my work in that effort was to convert the rig so that it could be used with this new MTG system. And then I worked as a rig engineer to support, you know, drilling operations for several years off of the West Coast. There was also a subsea tree that was developed and a flow line connection system that was based on this Marine Technology Group effort. And it was applied in the Gulf of Mexico. There was a test completion made in South Marsh Island, I think it was 73 field, in relatively shallow water, probably in 120 or 30 feet of water. And with that system, you know, a well was drilled, you know, the well was completed. The Christmas tree was installed, flow lines were installed, and the well was produced for a period of time. In Houston, under the direction of Carl Wickheiser, and we studied floating drilling system, or floating production systems, tanker-based systems. We studied TLPs, and we studied fully remote subsea systems. And it was decided that Shell should pursue TLP effort. It looked like it was the best choice for us to apply our resources onto TLPs at that time. And so there were several it was a new team established and several people brought in to work on TLPs in it might have been 84, 85, 86 in that time period. And so I joined one of those teams working on TLP well systems. And we did different kinds of feasibility studies. And our efforts, it turned out, were very closely aligned to the floating drilling and subsea efforts that we'd done before. We were only applying them in a little different fashion. So some of the same techniques for working in deep water drilling the wells were applicable to use on a TLP. So it was a marriage, so to speak, of floating drilling methods with civil engineering solutions, floating structures, and in particular, in this case, a TLP. At that time, we were, I look back, and we were really very green in our ideas on what we could do and what we couldn't do, and we took some significant risks, and our company really had a lot of confidence in the technical people that were working on the project, and fortunately, it all turned out successfully on our first project, which was Auger, and so we went from a feasibility study into a design phase and then into a build phase in a fairly rapid fashion. And different from lots of companies, Shell pretty much designed Auger in-house. I mean, we used lots of contractors, but we had our own civil engineering team, and we had a lot of folks who worked on the well systems and on the topside facilities. So rather than going to a general contractor to help us build this deep water facility, we pretty much did it ourselves. And it was a real challenge for our group. It was a real learning experience, and I think most of us who worked on it really felt lucky to have had the chance to work on such a significant project. And I felt extremely lucky to work on it because having worked in the area of that I had in the Mobot system on the West Coast and working in subsea completions before, I felt that I was able to apply some of my experiences very well in Auger, and that it was a meaningful project for Shell in order to viably produce our deep water prospects.